we shall send you in ever-increasing numbers. Ships, planes, tanks, guns. That is our purpose and our pledge.
To the people of Britain, besieged and alone since the fall of France in June 1940, American supplies of food, arms, and raw materials offer the only hope of survival. In March 1941, the American President Franklin D. Roosevelt signs the Lend-Lease Act, ensuring that Britain does not have to make immediate cash payment for the goods it receives. Nevertheless, Britain's future still hangs in the balance. The long Atlantic voyage is fraught with danger. Convoys that survive the gauntlet of German U-boats can still meet with tragedy as German bombers strike far out to sea.
We're now picked up, I think I'm right in saying, the first attack on a convoy which has been actually recorded at sea. We've been attacked by bombers. There have been two runs over the convoy as yet. All the ships have been just blazing off like mad. They put stick of bombs, but so far no damage has been done. So I've taken up a position by the gun in the stern. It's a 12-pounder, and I'm right amidst the gun crew now. Shells all around me, two and four, are being handed up from the magazine below. I take it in here, the crew. And wait a minute. Here he comes. He's on our port quarter. Not much more than 500 feet up, I should say, and just about abreast of us now. The tracer bullets bursting all around him. He's passing astern, straight over, but you can still follow him through this night cloud. And there go his bombs, and a stick of four of them. They're hanging in the air for a moment. I can see them distinctly, and now they're dropping down over the convoy. But wait a minute, he is missed. Columns of water spouting up, but he's missed. The ships are still there, and it looks as if we're all right. We've got the faint smell of gunpowder and smoke drifting across the water, but we won't worry about that. He's missed, and everything's okay.
Throughout 1941, losses of merchant ships far outstripped Britain's ability to replace them. With its Atlantic lifeline close to severed, the British war economy is being slowly strangled. Food supplies, too, are severely affected. The result is a new mood of near despondency. It is a mood that the news from North Africa can only serve to deepen. On February the 12th, 1941, Erwin Rommel had arrived in Tripoli with a small force of tanks and instructions to wait for reinforcements before taking any major action. Ignoring his orders, Rommel quickly mounts an improvised offensive. Shocked by the speed of the Axis assault, British advance positions collapse in disarray. All the British gains of the previous months are lost, and the vital port of Tobruk is left besieged. Under intense pressure from Churchill, the Commander-in-Chief of Middle Eastern Forces, General Wavell, launches a hastily prepared operation to relieve Tobruk. The attack, codenamed Battle Axe, begins on June the 14th. Rommel's Africa Corps is equipped with 12 new 88mm guns, dual-purpose weapons equally effective in anti-aircraft or anti-tank roles. The 88s wreak havoc with the British Army. In 3 days of battle, the British lose 91 tanks, almost half of their total force. Battle Axe is little short of a catastrophe. It will be 6 months before Britain can again mount an offensive in North Africa. Meanwhile, the focus of the entire war shifts to a new arena, the vast expanses of the Soviet Union.
At 4 o'clock this morning, Hitler attacked and invaded Russia. This was no surprise to me. In fact, I gave clear and precise warning to Stalin of what was coming. I gave him warnings, as I have given warnings to others before. Hitler is a monster of wickedness, insatiable in his lust for blood and plunder. So now this bloodthirsty gutter snipe must launch his mechanized armies upon new fields of slaughter, pillage, and devastation.
Operation Barbarossa, the invasion of the Soviet Union, is launched on June the 22nd, 1941. 3 million troops and over 3,000 tanks surge into Soviet territory along a 2,000-mile front. It is blitzkrieg on a gigantic scale. For Hitler, the conquest of the Soviet Union is a long-cherished ambition. Already, the assault has been delayed over a month by his decision to invade Yugoslavia and Greece and by shortages of equipment. But Hitler is confident that victory will be his. The German army, Hitler declares, has only to kick in the door and the whole house will come crashing down. The German strategy involves three gigantic thrusts, one to the northeast towards Leningrad, another into the Ukraine and the oil fields of the Caucasus, and the third, and most powerful, a drive towards Moscow. The aim is not just to seize territory, but to destroy the Red Army. At first, Hitler's confidence seems entirely justified. By July the 9th, Army Corps Center has punched through to Minsk and captured 290,000 prisoners and vast numbers of tanks. Another encirclement near Smolensk captures 300,000. The history of warfare has never before seen victories on such a scale. By mid-July, Army Group Center is only 200 miles from Moscow. The High Command, seeing the Soviet capital as the great prize, begs Hitler to sanction an all-out drive to capture the city. To their consternation, Hitler refuses. His priorities lie with the Caucasian oil fields and the city of Leningrad. To achieve these objectives, Army Group Center is stripped of several divisions of infantry and armor. Moscow can wait. My generals, Hitler pronounces, know nothing of the economic aspects of war. The offensive south to the Caucasus is a brilliant tactical success. The city of Kiev falls on September the 19th. A week later, in a great battle of encirclement, 665,000 Soviet prisoners are taken. Hitler's armies have won what he calls the greatest battle in the history of the world. What Hitler does not realize is that he is already on the road to losing the war. The drive on Moscow is resumed on October the 2nd. At first, all goes well for the Germans. In a set-piece battle near Bryansk, two Soviet armies are destroyed and 650,000 prisoners are taken. By October the 20th, the Germans are within 40 miles of Moscow. Even Hitler's generals, until now nervous and doubtful, come to believe that the city could be theirs before they must face the severities of the Russian winter. What they fail to anticipate is rain. Known to the Russians as the season of mud, late autumn brings an endless downpour which transforms the Russian landscape into a quagmire. Speed and mobility, the pillars upon which German military doctrine has been built, soon become distant memories. By mid-October, rain has given way to snow. As the temperature plunges, the lack of winter clothing demoralizes men already at the limits of exhaustion. Engines refuse to start. Fuel freezes. Machine guns cease to function. Tank tracks freeze rigid and telescopic sights become useless. Worst of all, a new and highly maneuverable Soviet tank, the T-34, is encountered in large numbers. It is a formidable weapon. Its armor immune to most German anti-tank guns. Adolf Hitler, whose armies have advanced 500 miles, winning victory after victory, is adamant that the Red Army must be on the point of final collapse. At the very gates of Moscow, he has deployed the greatest tank force ever concentrated on a single front. One great push must decide the issue. Hitler orders an all-out assault for December the 1st. In appalling conditions, the German offensive succeeds in penetrating to the Moscow suburbs. Reconnaissance units can clearly see the domes of the Kremlin. But as Soviet defenders bitterly contest every yard of ground, the temperature plunges to minus 40 degrees. The German tanks, never designed to operate in such a climate, are virtually immobilized. The defense of Moscow has been entrusted to the Soviet general Georgi Zhukov, a master of mechanized warfare. By holding the Germans until now, he's been able to reinforce the city with fresh divisions from the Soviet Far East and Siberia. On December the 16th, Zhukov strikes. Seven armies and two cavalry corps, 100 divisions trained and equipped for winter warfare, are unleashed on a 200-mile front. The Soviet onslaught, mounted with forces whose existence the German high command has not even suspected, comes as a shattering blow. The German armies are sent reeling, leaving behind 55,000 dead. It is a shock from which the confidence of the Wehrmacht will never fully recover.
Here is the news. Japan's long-threatened aggression in the Far East began tonight with air attacks on United States naval bases in the Pacific. Fresh reports are coming in every minute. The latest facts of the situation are these.
In this nation's capital, the Japanese attack on Hawaii and the Philippine Islands and the torpedo assault on two American cargo ships in the Pacific have come with an electrifying shock. There are crowds right now gathered in front of the White House and the State Department and the Japanese Embassy.
No matter how long it may take us to overcome this premeditated invasion, the American people in their righteous might will win through to absolute victory. Congress declare that since the unprovoked and dastardly attack by Japan on Sunday, December 7th, 1941, a state of war has existed between the United States and the Japanese Empire.
This is the BBC Home and Forces program. Here's the news. This is Wilfred Pickles reading it. This morning's news of Japan's aggression is of successful countermeasures against the invasion of Malaya. There have also been reports of enemy attacks on Thailand and Hong Kong. At Shanghai, the Japanese have taken over the international waterfront and sunk the British gunboat Petrel. President Roosevelt has spoken of serious damage and casualties in the earlier
After the outrages they have committed upon us at Pearl Harbor, in the Pacific Islands, in the Philippines, in Malaya, and the Dutch East Indies, they must now know that the stakes for which they have decided to play are mortal. When we look at the resources of the United States and the British Empire compared to those of Japan, when we remember those of China, which have so long valiantly withstood invasions and tyranny, and when also we observe the Russian menace which hangs over Japan, it becomes still more difficult to reconcile Japanese action with prudence or even with sanity. What kind of a people do they think we are? Is it possible they do not realize that we shall never cease to persevere against them until they have been taught a lesson which they and the world will never forget?
The Japanese attacks on Pearl Harbor and Britain's Far Eastern colonies come like a bolt from the blue. The American Pacific Fleet is crippled, with the loss of 4 battleships sunk and 4 damaged. 10 other warships sunk and 349 aircraft destroyed. Yet, catastrophic as the blow at first seems, all 4 Pacific Fleet aircraft carriers are away at the time of the raid. And the massive supplies of oil kept on Hawaii, a quantity greater than Japan's entire stock, remain intact. No attempt has been made to capture the island of Oahu, the United States' most important Pacific naval base. For these missed opportunities, Japan will pay dear. The Japanese attack surprises Germany almost as much as it does the United States. Hitler had promised the Japanese that Germany would join with them in any war against the Americans. And he is filled with admiration at the decisive way the blow has been struck. On December the 11th, 1942, Germany and Italy declare war on the United States. Whatever benefit Hitler might have expected from war between the United States and Japan, he now faces a formidable alliance. Britain, the Soviet Union, and the United States, the 3 greatest industrial powers on Earth, are now ranged against him. At a conference in Washington, Churchill and Roosevelt agree that of the 2 great enemies, Germany and Japan, priority is to be given to the defeat of Germany. the only theater of war in which British and German forces can fight face to face on land is in North Africa. By early January in 1942, the British have relieved Tobruk and pushed Rommel back to El Agheila. On the 21st, Rommel once more takes the initiative. The British are forced to retreat to a defensive line at Gazala, where they dig in and wait for reinforcements. On March the 28th, the French port of Saint-Nazaire is the target of the most audacious British commando raid of the war. A force of 260 men aboard the destroyer Campbelltown and 18 assault craft storm one of the German Navy's most important facilities in France. The destroyer, packed with high explosives, rams and destroys the port's lock gates. The intention is to deny the German battleship Tirpitz the use of dock facilities. In the raid on Saint-Nazaire, 16 British assault craft are sunk and 170 commandos killed or captured. But the attack is a complete success. Saint-Nazaire's port facilities will remain out of commission for most of the remainder of the war. In North Africa, the British defensive line at Gazala has been reinforced by large numbers of American-built Grant tanks. They are poorly deployed, and Rommel's attack on May the 28th cuts clean through the British flank. British counterattacks fail, and Rommel sweeps northeast. In one battle alone, the British leave 260 tanks smoldering in the desert. As the newly named 8th Army breaks into full retreat, Rommel attacks Tobruk. The town falls in a single day. 33,000 British soldiers are taken prisoner and vast quantities of precious supplies are captured. On June the 21st, the day he captures Tobruk, Rommel is promoted to Field Marshal. 2 days later, he is on the offensive once more. His aim is the total defeat of the British in North Africa. Within days, Rommel has pushed the 8th Army so far into Egypt that there is panic in Cairo. With his front line only 60 miles from Alexandria, Rommel's offensive finally grinds to a halt. The British, having lost 75,000 men and reduced to 200 tanks, hold a line at El Alamein. Rommel's supply lines are stretched to the limit, and he is down to 30 battle-ready tanks. While the British and Axis armies have been trading blows in the deserts of North Africa, events in the Pacific had moved with startling rapidity. The Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor in December 1941 is followed by a virtual carbon copy air assault on American bases in the Philippines. In spite of warnings, American aircraft are once again caught on the ground. American air power in the Pacific is smashed at a single stroke. Subsequent Japanese landings force the Americans to retreat to the Bataan Peninsula. On December the 25th, the British colony of Hong Kong is stormed and its 12,000 strong garrison forced to surrender. The British are compelled to withdraw from Malaya by a much weaker force of Japanese. Even more deeply humiliating, Singapore is captured with almost 140,000 British and Commonwealth troops taken prisoner. In the Battle of the Java Sea on January the 27th, 1942, a combined British, American and Dutch fleet is smashed by Japanese warships. By March, the Dutch East Indies have fallen, and the British are forced to abandon most of Burma and retire to the Indian border. The remnants of American forces in the Philippines clinging to the Bataan Peninsula are defeated in April, and the fortified island of Corregidor is soon captured. In 6 months, the Japanese have conquered a vast area of the globe for negligible losses to themselves. However, as Germany had found to its cost in the Soviet Union, tactical successes are no guarantee of victory in war. Spread across an enormous swathe of the Pacific and Southeast Asia, the Japanese fail to concentrate their efforts on a single objective. There is conflict between the army and the navy about where to strike next. Port Moresby in New Guinea to cut off Australia, the American Aleutian Islands in the Northern Pacific, or the island of Midway to draw out US naval power and defeat it. Fatally, all three operations are attempted at once. The result is a major Japanese defeat at Midway. The commander of the Japanese combined fleet, Admiral Yamamoto, wrongly believes that the American carriers Yorktown and Lexington have already been sunk, and that his attack on Midway cannot be opposed by US air power. His own main force consists of 7 battleships and 51,000 invasion troops, but only a single aircraft carrier. On June the 3rd, the Japanese begin diversionary attacks on the Western Aleutians. But the Americans are decoding Japanese naval signals and know that the real attack is to be directed at Midway. Japanese carrier-based aircraft pound the Midway airbase. 33 American planes are destroyed. On the following day, the second phase begins. Midway's defenses are to be finally crushed by a full-scale bombing offensive on the island. As Japanese aircraft are being armed and refueled for the attack, the American carriers strike. The first wave of US torpedo bombers is almost annihilated by the Japanese flak and fighter cover. Only 6 out of 41 aircraft survive, and the Japanese fleet remains unscathed. A second wave, this time of dive bombers, finds its target. In minutes, the Americans wreak havoc. Four Japanese carriers are sunk for the loss of the American carrier Yorktown. It is the end of Japanese air superiority in the Pacific. It is also the first major defeat for the Japanese Empire. By the summer of 1942, the German armies on the Russian front have once more gathered their strength. The Soviet counteroffensive at Moscow had been stalled, and the German armies saved from total rout by Hitler's refusal to allow a general retreat. The chief of the Army High Command and 35 generals have been sacked, and Hitler has taken personal control of the war in the East. Now he once more looks to the prize he most covets, the oil fields of the Caucasus. The campaign is codenamed Case Blue. On June the 28th, 1942, the Great Offensive opens, with Army Group South smashing eastwards to the Don and capturing the city of Verenay. The corridor between the rivers Don and Donets is now secure, and the Germans can commence their great drive south. To protect the march on the Caucasus, German forces are divided in two. While one advances into the southern oil fields, the other is to attack and capture the key city of Stalingrad, severing Soviet communications with the south. As 300,000 German troops are committed to an epic battle which will rage for 5 months. In North Africa, German forces are also about to launch an historic offensive. By late July 1942, both sides in the desert struggle have fought themselves to a standstill. Rommel is desperately short of supplies, and above all, fuel. But by August, he has increased his armored strength to 203 German and 240 Italian tanks. With Allied air attacks on his extended supply lines increasingly effective, Rommel concludes that he must strike at once in the hope of final victory or face the piecemeal disintegration of his fighting strength. The British are now receiving vast quantities of American equipment, and delay can only work in their favor. What is more, the Eighth Army has a new commander, Lieutenant General Bernard Montgomery.
Here we will stand and fight. There will be no further withdrawal. I have ordered that all plans and instructions dealing with further withdrawal are to be burnt. And at once, we will stand and fight here.
After lengthy preparation and a massive build-up of superiority in men and equipment, Montgomery's assault is launched on the night of October the 23rd. The Battle of El Alamein opens with a massive bombardment by British artillery, closely followed by infantry assaults on the heavily mined Axis lines. The success of Montgomery's plan depends on the infantry clearing corridors through which the tanks can advance. The Italians, blocking the British advance, put up fierce resistance, and a counterattack by the German 15th Panzer Division comes close to stopping the attack in its tracks. On the 25th, a second assault by tanks of the British 10th Corps also fails to break the Axis line. Montgomery is forced to change his plans. Fierce battles rage for a week before Rommel is finally compelled to withdraw 3 miles to escape encirclement. He is fast running out of supplies, and his tank strength is being steadily eroded. On November the 1st, the decisive blow is struck. A determined assault by the 2nd New Zealand Division wins a corridor for the British Army. Rommel knows that if he does not disengage, his forces will be destroyed utterly. Hitler vehemently refuses to allow a retreat. For 2 disastrous days, Rommel obeys his orders. Finally, on November the 5th, on his own initiative, he decides to withdraw. He has lost 35,000 men and is reduced to 22 tanks.
This is the BBC Home and Forces program. This is Bruce Belfridge. Here's some excellent news which has come during the past hour
in the form of a communique from GHQ Cairo. It says, the Axis forces in the Western Desert, after 12 days and nights of ceaseless attacks by our land and air forces, are now in full retreat. It's known that the enemy's losses in killed and wounded have been exceptionally high. Up to date, we've destroyed more than 260 German and Italian tanks and captured or destroyed at least 270 guns.
The British victory at El Alamein is the beginning of the end of the German presence in North Africa. On November the 8th, Anglo-American invasion forces land in Morocco and Algeria. These, the first American ground actions in the European war, herald the dawn of a new era of Anglo-American joint operations. It is also the testing ground for future Allied invasions of Europe. By mid-November 1942, the German Sixth Army in Stalingrad has suffered appalling losses. Every street, house and factory has been bitterly contested. But Hitler is convinced that Russian resolve will soon collapse. In reality, secret Soviet reserve armies, until now husbanded even in the most dire emergencies, are to be thrown into a massive counteroffensive. The battle begins on November the 19th. In two great thrusts, the Soviet armies crash into Italian and Romanian lines on the Germans' northwest flank. A third attack strikes to the south. Under the weight of an onslaught of such ferocity, the Axis defenders are overrun. After 4 days, Soviet spearheads meet. A giant pincer has closed around Stalingrad. The German 6th Army and part of the 4th Panzer Army, 300,000 men, are trapped in the ruins of the city. Characteristically, Hitler forbids any attempt at a breakout. Stalingrad must be defended to the last drop of German blood. On January the 23rd, 1943, the Red Army unleashes its final assault. The exhausted German defenders, freezing, starving, and almost out of ammunition, are caught in a rapidly shrinking pocket. Luftwaffe attempts to supply them by air have long since failed, and the last usable airfield has fallen to the Soviets. In 11 days, the battle is over. The 6th Army commander, General von Paulus, surrenders on February the 2nd. 150,000 Germans have died. 90,000 are taken prisoner. Of these, only 7,000 will survive Soviet captivity. For Germany, it is the greatest disaster in its military history. For the Allies, it is the turning point of the war. While the battle for Stalingrad was still raging, Winston Churchill and Franklin D. Roosevelt had met in the Moroccan city of Casablanca. Churchill had made his priorities clear. The Allies must defeat the remaining Axis forces in Tunisia and then move on to knock Italy out of the war. Roosevelt realizes that there can be no invasion of France in 1943 and is anxious to concentrate American efforts on the Pacific. As a compromise, the two agree that after clearing North Africa, they would mount a joint invasion of Sicily. In Tunisia, Axis forces had stabilized a strong defensive line and had been heavily reinforced. The advancing Americans are severely mauled at the Kasserine Pass, and it is late March before a British offensive can break the Axis line. Joint British-American actions continue until Axis forces surrender on May the 11th, 1943. 275,000 Italian and German prisoners are taken. The way is now clear for the Allies to strike at Sicily. Operation Husky begins on July the 10th. Seaborne landings by Montgomery's 8th Army and Patton's U.S. 7th Army achieve almost complete tactical surprise. The 8th Army's drive for Messina is, however, met by fierce German resistance, while the Americans sweep through western Sicily, taking Palermo on July the 22nd. By mid-August, Axis forces are committed to a full-scale evacuation from Sicily. In 38 days, the Axis loses 160,000 killed, wounded, or captured for Allied casualties of only 16,000. The conquest of Sicily has political as well as military consequences. On July the 24th, Mussolini is deposed by army conspirators, and the new Italian leader, Marshal Badoglio, begins to negotiate for peace. The very same day, the German city of Hamburg is annihilated by British bombers. The firestorms raging in Hamburg, fueled by a week of nightly bombing, kill more than 50,000 civilians. The aim of the combined bomber offensive, which will pound German cities until mid-1944, is to destroy German war production and crush the morale of the civilian population. In fact, it will achieve neither. German arms production continues to increase dramatically, and the civil population is mobilized by the common threat as it has never been mobilized before. The cost to the RAF and American bomber fleets is enormous. Fighters and radar-directed flak account for thousands of aircraft. RAF Bomber Command alone will suffer more than 30,000 aircrew killed. In spite of the sacrifices of Allied airmen, the greatest blow suffered by Hitler's military machine in 1943 is not inflicted by Allied bombing. It is struck by the Red Army on the Eastern Front. In July, a massive German armored offensive at Kursk culminates in the greatest tank battle in history. First pulverized by deep Soviet defenses, the German army is finally smashed in running battles involving up to 1,000 tanks at a time. 20 German panzer divisions are utterly routed, losing 1,500 tanks. On August the 3rd, the Soviet counteroffensive begins. It is the start of a great push which will, in 20 months, take the Red Army to the very heart of Germany.
Today, the 3rd of September, we enter the 5th year of the war. And today, the 8th Army, having fought its way from Egypt to Tunisia, and then crossed the seas to Sicily, has landed on the mainland of the continent of Europe. We have a good plan and air support on a greater scale than we have ever had before. There can only be one end to this next battle, and that is another success. Forward to victory. Let us knock Italy out of the war.
Within the first few days of their landings in Italy, both British and American invasion forces break out of their beachheads and push inland. But the Germans are quick to regroup. Only Allied naval gunfire prevents counterattacks breaking through to the vulnerable beachheads. Six days after the Allied invasion, the Italian government requests an armistice. At once, the German army occupies Rome. In Naples, there is a popular rebellion against the Germans. Bloody fighting continues for 3 days.
Here is the news, and this is Friedrich Kreiswood reading. 2 hours ago, Italy declared war on Germany. Proclamation by Marshal Badoglio brands the Germans for savagery against the civil population and says there can be no peace while a single German remains on Italian soil. Italy's new step has been acknowledged in London, Washington, and Moscow. Her status will be that of a co-belligerent, not an ally. The terms of the armistice with the Allied command remain in full force.
As the Allies first consolidate their hold on southern Italy and then begin a slow and costly push to Rome, the entire emphasis of Allied strategy shifts dramatically. The Tehran Conference of November 1943 leads to an historic decision. The major effort of the Western Allies will not take place in Italy. Instead, Allied power will be concentrated in Britain for an invasion of France. By the spring of 1944, 3 million fighting men have been assembled in Britain for the coming invasion. Thousands of ships have disgorged over 5 million tons of American military equipment. A joint British-American staff is created, with General Dwight D. Eisenhower as supreme Allied commander. Montgomery is recalled from Italy to command all land forces during the opening phase of the campaign. After much debate, a decision is taken to strike at Normandy, west of the River Seine, rather than at the more heavily fortified area of the Pas-de-Calais. To mislead the Germans, a massive disinformation campaign is begun, involving heavy Allied radio traffic with a non-existent invasion force in Kent. More bombing raids are directed at the Pas-de-Calais than at the true target area in Normandy. Adolf Hitler knows that an invasion of France is a certainty. The question is, where will it come? Hitler's commander-in-chief West, von Rundstedt, believes that the Allied blow will fall on the Pas-de-Calais. Rommel, who has direct access to Hitler and a virtually independent command, is convinced that Normandy is the target. Hitler agrees with him, but uncharacteristically does not decisively back Rommel's judgment. He divides German ground forces equally, east and west of the Seine. Rommel and von Rundstedt also disagree about how best to counter the landings. Rommel favors destroying the invaders on the beaches. Von Rundstedt believes that the German armor should be held in reserve to launch a counteroffensive after the Allies have landed. Again, Hitler remains on the sidelines. There is no real preparation for either defense. As the Germans debate, the opening phase of Operation Overlord, the Allied invasion of France, is already underway. A massive air assault on roads, bridges, rail junctions and canals severs communications and isolates the German army in the Pas-de-Calais. It is a brilliant use of tactical air power. While the Allied buildup in Britain reaches its climax, the war in Italy is tying down 23 German divisions. Allied landings at Anzio are the objects of repeated German counterattacks. And the Eighth Army makes a direct frontal assault on the Gustav Line, heavily defended by powerful German formations. Blocking the Allied advance on Rome is the hilltop monastery of Monte Cassino. On February the 15th, the monastery had been bombed by Allied aircraft, but the Germans had held on tenaciously amongst the rubble. On May the 11th, British, French, Polish, American, and Canadian units mount a determined attack on the abbey. The capture of Monte Cassino on May the 17th at last opens the road to Rome. The American Fifth Army commander, General Clark, is now presented with a golden opportunity to encircle two entire German armies. Instead, on June the 4th, he enters the Italian capital, allowing the Germans to withdraw to the north and establish a new defensive line. As a result, victory in Italy will elude the Allies until May 1945. D-Day, the date for the invasion of Normandy, has been set for June the 5th. On that day, moon and tide will be at their most favorable. But everything depends on the weather, and the forecast is not good. With men and equipment already embarked, the nightmare of Allied planners seems to be coming true. A violent storm sweeps from the Atlantic to batter the Channel ports. If the invasion goes ahead, the landing grounds will be the scene of unimaginable chaos. On June the 5th, the meteorologists predict that the following morning will bring a break in the weather. Eisenhower faces a stark choice. A mistake could lead to the deaths of an estimated 150,000 men. Yet, the invasion force, keyed up to fever pitch, cannot be kept waiting indefinitely. Eisenhower's decision is to go.
On the eve of this great adventure, I send my best wishes to every soldier in the Allied team. To us is given the honor of striking a blow for freedom which will live in history. And in the better days that lie ahead, men will speak with pride of our doings. We have a great and a righteous cause. Let us pray that the Lord, mighty in battle, will go forth with our army, and that his special providence will aid us in the struggle. I want every soldier to know that I have complete confidence in the successful outcome of the operations that we are now about to begin. With stout hearts and with enthusiasm for the contest, let us go forward to victory.
At dawn on June the 6th, Operation Overlord begins. The first waves of airborne troops have already landed behind the German lines. Sailing for France is the 150,000 strong first contingent of Montgomery's 21st Army Group.
BBC Home Service. Here is a special bulletin read by John Snagg. D-Day has come. Early this morning, the Allies began the assault on the northwestern face of Hitler's European fortress. The first official news came just after 9:30, when Supreme Headquarters of the Allied Expeditionary Force, usually called SHAPE from its initials, issued communique number one. This said, under the command of General Eisenhower, Allied naval forces supported by strong air forces began...
This is the day and this is the hour. The sky is lightning. Lightning over the coast of Europe as we go in. The sky is lighter and the sea is brighter, but along the shore there's a dense smoke screen as the battleships and the warships, the smaller warships, sweep along there, firing all the time against the shore and some of them laying a smoke screen for us. The sun is blazing down brightly now. It's almost like an omen, the way it suddenly come out just as we were going in. The whole sky is bright. The sea is a glittering mass of silver, with all these craft of every kind moving across it, and the great battleships in the background blazing away at the shore. There go the craft past us, the other landing craft. Some are left behind, the slower ones, each taking their part and going in at the right time for their right job. Destroyers, corvettes, patrol buses. I can hear the sound of anti-aircraft fire. I can't see yet whether it's our people who are being attacked. There's an enormous cloud of smoke along the shore, not only from the smoke screen, but from this terrific bombardment. All the ships are blazing away now. You can't imagine anything like this march of ships, like soldiers marching in line. I've never seen anything so expressive of intense. It's a purpose shared among many ships and among many hundreds of thousands of fighting men who are going in now to the coast of Europe to do the biggest job they've ever had to do. I can't record any more now because the time has come for me to get my kit on my back and get ready to step off on that shore. And it's a great day.
As the first wave of Allied infantry hits the beaches, none can know what lies in store. But the great secret, the place and time of the invasion, has been kept. It is late morning before Hitler even hears of the Normandy landings, and late evening before Rommel can reach his own headquarters. By then, the Allies have landed 150,000 troops for the loss of only 2,000 men. Any hope that they can be swept from the beaches is fading by the hour.
We're over the enemy coast now, and the run-in has started. 1 minute, 30 seconds, red light, green light, and out, out, get on, get out, get out. Out fast into the cool night. Out, out into the air over France. And we know that the dropping zone is obstructed. We're dropping, in fact, into fields covered with poles. But I hit my chute and lower my kit bag, which suspends on the end of a 40-foot rope from my harness. And then the ground comes up to hit me, and I find myself in the middle of a cornfield.
The paratroops are landing. They're landing all around me as I speak. They've come in from the sea, and they're fluttering down, red, white, and blue parachutes fluttering down, and they're just about the best thing that we've seen for a good many hours. They're showering in. There's no other word for it.
By June the 12th, the third wave of Allied divisions has landed in France. The expeditionary force now holds a strip of coastline 60 miles long and 12 miles deep. The feared German counteroffensive has failed to materialize. As the beachheads link up and expand, each pushes further inland to join with growing numbers of airborne troops already in possession of key points. 360,000 Allied soldiers are now on French soil. Hitler still believes that the main Allied effort will come in the Pas-de-Calais and that the Normandy landings are merely a diversion. He refuses to allow his forces to make an orderly withdrawal to new defensive positions and fails to realize that the port of Cherbourg is the main Allied objective. To the consternation of his commanders, Hitler is pinning his faith on a new secret weapon, the V-1 flying bomb. The first V-1 raid on Britain comes on June the 12th. The effect is more terrifying than a fleet of German bombs. A single V-1 carries almost a ton of high explosives, and there can be no real warning of a raid. Life becomes one long air raid alert. Half of the 1,500 V-1s launched in June are shot down over open country, but those that get through kill over 500 Londoners every week. Hitler's faith in the V-1 is utterly misplaced. Most people in Britain believe that the war will be over in months and that Hitler's new weapon can have no real impact on British morale. The war will be won or lost, not in the skies over Britain, but on the battlefields of France. On June the 27th, Cherbourg falls to the Allies. But to the east, a powerful German force of 7 armored divisions and 2 infantry divisions bars the British advance on the city of Caen. On July the 8th, units of the 2nd Army succeed in penetrating the city, but are stalled at the Orne crossings. Montgomery's Operation Goodwood, a drive by 3 British armored divisions towards the rear of the German defenses, is also blocked. While British actions at Caen draw off the bulk of the German army, the American First Army fights its way into Saint-Lô on July the 18th, and after a fierce Allied air offensive, breaks through German lines at Avranches. Patton's Third Army surges through the gap into Britain. Wheeling north, Patton drives behind the German armor and races towards the French capital. On August the 19th, with American forces approaching Paris, the French National Council of Resistance gives its partisans the order for insurrection. For 4 days, street battles rage throughout the city. French leaders are determined that the capital should be liberated by its own citizens. On August the 23rd, after a bitter struggle, resistance forces succeed in freeing the greater part of Paris. To the south of the city, French troops fighting with the American 5th Corps are closing in. The 4th French Armored Division has already penetrated the suburbs. 2 days later, Charles de Gaulle enters the capital.
Here is the news, read by Richard Weston. Paris has been liberated. A communique just received from General Koenig announces that it has been liberated by French forces of the interior.
Seven days after the liberation of Paris, Hitler seeks revenge with another secret weapon. 2 V-2 rockets are fired at the city, but both explode harmlessly in flight. Two days later, the V-2 is turned on Britain. Over 1,000 rockets are fired at London, and over 500 reach their target, killing 2,700 people. There can be no effective defense. Only when Allied forces overrun their launch sites will the menace of the V-2 be ended.
I want today, 17th of September, to speak to all soldiers in the group of armies under my command. What a change has come over the scene since I last spoke to you on the 21st of August. The Allies have removed the enemy from practically the whole of France and Belgium, except in a few places, and we stand at the door of Germany.
On December the 16th, 1944, the optimism of the Allies suffers a brutal shock. The Germans launch a powerful counteroffensive in the Ardennes. The intention is to open a route to Antwerp and split the Allied armies in two. The Battle of the Bulge is Hitler's last great gamble. The offensive opens with Allies severely handicapped as poor weather renders their air power useless. The Germans have assembled 24 divisions for the attack, including 10 armored divisions. Achieving complete surprise, they slam into the unsuspecting Americans. Two US infantry divisions are smashed. While American reinforcements are rushed to the battle zone, some isolated garrisons succeed in holding out, and the German effort is severely hampered by blocked communications. On the 26th of December, the weather finally clears and the Allies can at last unleash their tactical air power. The result is a disaster for Germany. 120,000 men are lost, along with 600 tanks and 1,600 aircraft. After the Bulge, the German army will never mount a full-scale offensive again. While in the west, the Allies battle towards the Rhine. In the east, the Red Army is advancing on every front. On January the 12th, 1945, Russian forces break out south of Warsaw and push towards Silesia. Warsaw falls on January the 17th, and to the north, two Russian armies overrun vast tracts of East Prussia, cutting off huge numbers of German troops. The Soviet offensive, which follows, 180 divisions strong, advances 220 miles in 2 weeks. The Red Army front is now only 100 miles from Berlin.
Hello, BBC. This is Ian Wilson speaking from Supreme Headquarters. The Americans are over the Rhine. Supreme Headquarters announced a few minutes ago that General Hodges' 1st United States Army has crossed the Rhine. Elements reached the Rhine and crossed to establish a bridgehead on the east bank, somewhere south of Cologne.
Hello, BBC. This is Stuart McPherson reporting from Germany. One has only to spend a few minutes among our advancing troops on the far side of the Rhine to feel the almost frenzied spirit of offense that is running through every single formation. This morning I went across one of the Rhine bridges, and all along the route I was staggered by the hustle and dash of every single formation, right down from the military police to squadron commanders who were racing tanks across the river and far beyond on the other side. Up to the time of the Rhine push, it had always been a good idea to slow down when approaching a bridge, for that was the direction that was glaring at you in bold red letters off a snow-white signboard. But no more. Things have changed. I had hardly put the nose of the car down towards the start of the bridge when an English policeman bellowed, "Come on, mate, flat out across that bridge."
The Allied crossing of the Rhine marks the final phase of the war in Europe. Germany's Western Front is still held by 70 German divisions, fighting stubbornly for every inch of their home. But to the east, the Red Army has mustered 2.5 million men for the final assault on the German capital. Three Soviet army groups with 6,000 tanks, 42,000 guns, and 7,500 aircraft are poised to thrust in great arcs north and south of Berlin. The last great offensive of World War II opens on April the 16th. In 3 days, the Soviets break through to the outskirts of Berlin. By April the 25th, the city is completely encircled. On the same day, Soviet and American armies meet at the River Elbe. The fate of the Third Reich is sealed.
East and West have met. At 20 minutes to 5 on Wednesday afternoon, April the 25th, 1945, American troops of General Bradley's 12th Army Group made contact with Soviet elements of Marshal Konev's 1st Ukrainian Army Group near the German town of Torgau on the Elbe. This is the news for which the whole Allied world has been waiting. Nazi Germany, tottering to her final collapse, has been split clean in half.
Now, in this, the most serious time of our modern age, I beg you to realize that the fight is on. I would only say that the men who have died in the Battle of Berlin have given their lives to show that whatever else happens, Germany will live. No coercion, no oppression, no measures of tyranny that any foreign foe can introduce will shatter Germany. Germany will live because the people of Germany have in them the secret of life, endurance, will, and purpose. And therefore I say to you, in these last words, you may not hear from me again for a few months. I say, Es lebe Deutschland. Heil Hitler. And farewell.
As Adolf Hitler, in his bunker deep beneath the Reichschancellery, refuses to concede the possibility of defeat, the Red Army smashes its way to the heart of the city. In 18 days, 93 German divisions have been destroyed. Now 30,000 desperate defenders and 2 million civilians are at the center of an inferno. On April the 30th, Soviet units reach the Reichstag itself.
This is London calling. Here is a news flash. The German radio has just announced that Hitler is dead. I repeat that. The German radio has just announced that Hitler is dead.
Hitler's order to fight on has cost over 1 million lives. The Red Army has suffered 305,000 casualties. 125,000 German civilians have perished in the rubble of the city. 6,000 have committed suicide. Berlin has been virtually annihilated.
This is the BBC Home Service. We're interrupting programs to make the following announcement. It is understood that in accordance with arrangements between the three great powers, an official announcement will be broadcast by the Prime Minister at 3 o'clock tomorrow, Tuesday afternoon, the 8th of May.
Yesterday morning at 2:41 a.m. at General Eisenhower's headquarters, General Jodl, the representative of the German High Command, and of Grand Admiral Dönitz, the designated head of the German state, signed the act of unconditional surrender of all German land, sea, and air forces in Europe to the Allied Expeditionary Force and simultaneously to the Soviet High Command. We may allow ourselves a brief period of rejoicing.
The Second World War is not yet over. The fight against Japan will continue for another 3 months. Yet the greater enemy has been decisively and unconditionally defeated. And for Europe, the long nightmare has at last come to an end. For the British people, there is a unique satisfaction. The knowledge that by defying Hitler in the dark days of 1940 and preserving an outpost of freedom on the very edge of Hitler's empire, they had laid the foundations for victory.